Brian Kerr exhorts the troops again.
In 2005, Brian Kerr's international football career was flying high. He was manager of the Irish team and a local hero.
It was a dreadful match. The tactics were bad. Mentally lazy on behalf of the coach.
Well, I don't see what Brian Kerr wants out there. I just don't see it. He doesn't seem to have a plan.
But a defeat to France in September of that year kick-started Kerr's mighty fall from grace. The penalty? Kerr lost Irish football's biggest job.
The roar goes up. Plenty of green shirts in the box.
I don't think this guy has the plot anymore.
He's just chancing to get results.
The referee has blown the final whistle and Ireland are out of the World Cup and Brian Kerr's tenure.
Oh my God, where's my phone? Someone from Ireland I'd say don't get scared off quick enough when they hear what the bills are. Hello?
4 years after losing his dream gig as Ireland's top soccer manager, Brian Kerr is on the road again, managing the Faroe Islands. In 5 days' time, he will lead what is possibly football's worst team against France, one of the best. Taking the job is a big gamble.
Well, I sort of had a crown, but I'm out on the road again. I'm on the road again.
I think it's an honour that someone should ask you to be a national team manager when you're not from the place. Even a country as small as the Faroe Islands, you know, I feel really good about it that they offered me the job.
The biggest population by far here is the sheep, you know. They're kind of everywhere.
Failure to guide Ireland to the 2006 World Cup finals led to Brian's downfall. The parting was bitter and he spent the last 4 years in the managerial wilderness.
No, it'd be a bit edgier this time, of course, because it's coming up to a game. I just wouldn't consider it as nerves, I just my focus is much clearer.
Kerr's appointment as Faroe Island manager caught many by surprise. The Faroes team are a blip in the world rankings and haven't won a game in 8 years. The upcoming David and Goliath match against France is unlikely to change that. Kerr risks a deja vu loss against the squad that helped crush his Irish football career.
Henry! Oh, that's a super goal by Thierry Henry!
Home for Kerr is now a remote archipelago adrift in the North Atlantic. The 18 Faroe Islands are connected by undersea tunnels and mountain passes across 540 square miles. There's one traffic light in the capital and a handful of prisoners in the local jail. Governed by Denmark, the Faroes have a population of 49,000, the size of Carlo. It's a small pool from which to pick an international football team.
So this is busy downtown Tórshavn. This might be a mad move to make, to drive into the Friday evening traffic in the middle of the town. But here you go. What's the prison? Because I had to go down there to fill in a form about me work permit.
How many people are in there?
12. I think they're in for course and not referees. This is the centre town. This is where it all happens, right? This is really now where the hot spots of town are, you know. As you can see, it's very busy and kind of frantic.
Brian is 4 months into his reign as Faroe manager. It's a chance to relaunch his international career, but the odds are stacked against him. Coaching the Faroes might just be the biggest mistake of Kerr's professional life.
Yeah, typical weather here now. Huh? Well, some people were surprised. They didn't know where the Faroe Islands were, but they knew they weren't particularly good. This is really an extraordinary challenge in terms of the number of obstacles there are in the way. The isolation of this place from the rest of Europe, from the possibility of games, from the possibility of the players playing in other countries.
It may be a fresh team, but Kerr retains the same management style, paternal, passionate, and with precision attention to detail.
We just cut it on Friday. Yeah. How wide were the blades?
Oh, a couple of centimetres.
That's good for the game, but not for training.
The Faroe squad is made up of amateur players, but in a few days' time, they'll go toe-to-toe with the mighty French.
This ain't gonna be easy.
That's the challenge. You've played them before. Many of you have been involved in playing them before, and you've done quite well. But we can do better here. Now we have a chance again at home, in the home game. I'm so busy here, and I can concentrate so much of the work. I don't have the distractions that I would have in a place where you're surrounded by your own people. Particularly in the first period that I'm here, I need to concentrate on it. I need to learn as much as I can. I need to involve myself in the culture of the people a little bit. And it's allowed me to do that.
For the last 4 months, the man from Drimna has immersed himself in the new job. 600 miles from home, Brian tours the Faroe Islands, scouting talent. He attends several matches weekly and loves it. Football has always been Brian Kerr's fix.
Oh, there's a match on. What the fucking match is on? You better go and have a look at a match.
Football is political, even in the Faroes. A friendly between visiting Danish and Faroese politicians catches Kerr's eye, as does Kai Leo, team striker and Faroese Prime Minister.
He's fouled. The Danish person won't be allowed to go back now. You have to stay here forever. He's injured.
Public are important because they love their football here. Even though they've one of the worst records in the world, they go to every game with a bit of enthusiasm. It doesn't take much to rouse them in the game. If you can mount any sort of an attack at all, it's cheer to the echo. It's a bit unusual in that way. So they're the people I want to try and cheer up.
Hello, hello.
How you doing? How are you? Well done. You did well. Yeah, I don't know about that penalty.
I have bought this one in Dublin.
Did you? It's a great coat, that. It looks like an Irish coat. All right.
It is.
Good Irish trade. Here, give us a look. It's all McGee from Donegal. Where would you get it? Well done. Good to see you. I'm very impressed. I like the moment you took it on your chest and played it off.
I'm ready on Wednesday. I'm ready.
I'm number nine. Number nine. Turn around. Give him a nine. It's good though.
Kai Leo, do you have any advice for Brian Kerr becoming the new manager of the Faroe Islands?
No, I'm not the right person to give Brian Kerr any advice.
He's playing politics now. He knows everything.
But I think a great discipline, and to get the players to train harder than they are doing now. Yeah. We need the passion, because we are not France. We are Faroe Island, so we need that passion.
Play in front of them. That's it. Go.
and sharp. Good. Put it in front where he's running onto it.
Brian's right-hand man with the national team is Jens Martin Knudsen, former goalkeeper. His quirky bobble hat caught media attention, but wasn't enough to spook opposing strikers. Faroe Island goalkeeping is a dogged and difficult task.
Maybe I have the World Cup record of goals against, but I must also be the World Cup holder of many saves during my career. I definitely will say so.
I look good.
Oh, I look good, huh?
We'd all do that one, huh?
We come up with some results now and then, and then it's very, very important to be on the team that day.
The Faroe team come from all walks of life: fishermen, carpenters, policemen, and students. Unlike the French, there are no full-time players with big league salaries. There's no celebrity lifestyle and little chance of reaching the World Cup finals. The Faroese play for the love of the game.
David and Goliath would be too small an analogy, I think, really. It'd be like a hill in the Phoenix Park compared to Kilimanjaro. It's unlikely that they're ever going to become players who are earning 50 or 100,000 euro a week or anything like it. So it's important that I respect the demands that are on them in their lifestyle outside football.
Sonny Olsen is one of the Faroe team's star players. Like most Faroese, he has two passions, fishing and football.
Brian is making a difference, yeah, of course. It's good to motivate the players just before the game. I like to have a trainer that has the passion, and really you can see it from his body language that he wants to win and he wants to create a great result. So I like that.
When not training or playing midfield, Sonny works at the local fish factory.
Of course, it would be nice if I could be a full-time pro and have this great experience, but I'm not thinking so much about this. I'm just a person like them, and I go in 100% to every game. And that's what I think about. It's not about these glamorous things.
Far from Irish family and friends, Brian fights lonely moments with football. Bright summer nights send him to the Faroes' four corners, picking players, but it's the dark winters ahead that will test local talent.
I wouldn't have come here unless I thought I could make a difference. I think every team I've ever had has been in better shape when I left it than what I inherited when I started.
In the cliff-hanging town of Fuglafur, the local side is pitted against Stremur in the Faroes' First Division. The national team medic is in the crowd. With 3 days to go before the big match against France, the doctor has a dilemma. Star player Christian Hulse may not be ready for the big match.
Jesus Christ, where'd you get the jail boards, kid?
Yeah, huh? Good.
It wasn't good.
No.
We can't. No chance for us.
No.
We'll make our mind up tomorrow quickly.
Years of calamitous results have not withered Faroese spirit, nor has Brian Kerr's pull no punches views on players, especially when it comes to style over substance.
They'd be the only team in the league playing 4-4-2. But everyone fucking plays 4-4-1-1 here. I don't know what they're afraid of. Why don't they fucking play 2 up, you know? Sometimes he plays outside left. Sometimes he plays fucking right back. He doesn't do anything great. He does a lot of things reasonably well. But a lot of people here think he's a fucking great player because he works terrible hard and he's a hairband. Okay, maybe. I might get one here.
Faroe grounds may be rugged, but there are still Irish comforts.
How are you?
Would it be possible to have a cup of tea or coffee? Could we have a cup of tea or a coffee? Yeah. Is it possible, yeah? Abram didn't tell you, no?
Lots of coffee.
Lots of what? Look at that chocolate cakes. Yeah. They keep that away from us. Huh? Ever seen a pitch in a more scenic place in your life? It wasn't an awful lot of sea and fjords and mountains around Drimnagh and Mawkinstown, mind you.
Brian Kerr was born one of five children in the working-class suburb of Drimnagh in Dublin. In the 1930s, his father Frank was a champion Irish boxer.
Well, here we are at the boxing session of the St. John Bosco Boys Club in Sperrin Road, Drimnagh. Well, I have Frankie here now with me. Do you feel more at home in this environment, Frankie, than in the studio?
Yes. Plenty of room, plenty of kids to chase around.
You know your ground here pretty well, I'd say.
By the 1960s, Frank Kerr's free time was spent coaching young boxers, always looking for the next big Irish talent. It's where Brian was baptised into his love of sport.
I could stroll into the dressing room, and I've never forgotten. It was almost like a religious ceremony before the fights, the preparation of the young boxers for fights, and the embalming of the hands, and the gloving up, as they called it, and the lacing of the gloves, and the quietness in the dressing room, the tension before the fight, which is, it really is an extraordinary tension.
Oh, come on, get them a bit straighter. Woo!
My own father basically worked a six-day week in his regular job, and then he seemed to be coaching for 7 days and seven nights as well. I didn't get to really know him in the way that you do. I think when you get a little bit more mature that you can have conversations with your father.
And we hope we'll see you on supporting you.
When Brian was 15, his father died.
Well, I'd love to do that. And I've enjoyed every minute of it. Every minute I've been out there.
Thanks very much, Frank.
Thank you, Brian.
I remember 2 days after the funeral that there was a game for the school. I think it was a semi-final of the Dublin Under 15 colleges. And I knew I had no hesitation about playing. I think I understood that that's what my dad would have wanted me to do. He didn't come too often to see me playing, but it was a kind of a disappointment later on, you know, that when people spoke about him, and I didn't get to see him. I've lots of good memories of the time with him, and somehow I think he may have transferred some of the organisational ability to me about working with teams.
Brian never made it as a player, but those coaching skills he gleaned from his father quickly turned his head towards management.
I was probably a bit mouthy when I was playing, and it came across that I knew a little bit about it, and I'd be maybe slightly mouthy in the dressing room about organisation, about what we wanted, you know. I got an awful lot of pleasure out managing teams. I felt I could control it much better. I could have much more influence on the result by being the manager than I was by being the player, and it just developed out of that. There certainly wouldn't be an autocratic manager. Neither would I be a completely democratic manager. I listen to people's opinions around the team and people that I respect, and I would certainly listen to the views of the players. But there are certain principles I have I wouldn't compromise. I think there's an old Chinese phrase about not criticising the man unless you've walked in the shoes. Well, you know, I much prefer to walk in these shoes.
My Achilles tendon has given me this very sore here, right, giving me jip, so I probably did a bit much this morning. I was up walking the hills this morning, you know, it's just a bit sore. I'm surrounded by such a fantastic medical team here that I won't have to go to Lourdes.
Brian Kerr's big break came in 1986 when he became manager of St. Patrick's Athletic. It was a club he'd idolised as a kid. He spent 10 eventful years there. He built a team from nothing and delivered two league titles against all the odds.
I had a
a loyalty streak in me that meant I, if I started something with a team, if the people were, if the people were supportive and loyal to me, I would be loyal to them.
In 1996, Brian was put in charge of all Irish underage football. He had a magic touch with amateur players. By 2002, he'd become the most successful Irish international manager of all time, winning two European championships and guiding Ireland's under-20s to a third-place finish at the World Cup.
And the success was just fairly amazing at the time, you know, for us to go to the World Cup and get to the semi-final out of nothing.
Kerr's unprecedented glory shone in the spotlight. In 2003, he was offered his dream job, manager of the Irish national football team.
I'll bring a bit of passion to it. I'll bring my own desire for success, not for me, but for the teams and for the people that are involved.
But Kerr's appointment raised eyebrows. Would his skills with amateurs translate to the big time?
It was a great day. I felt it was a little bit of kind of justice for those of us who had never played in England, who had never played at the highest level, because there's always this thing, if you haven't played at top level, sure, you know, you can't have respect and so on. So I felt that was a day for all those people who looked on sport and looked on Irish football the way I did. I generally hadn't ever applied for jobs in football. Maybe there was a pride about the possible rejection and applying for something and not getting it. Maybe they wouldn't give it to someone who talked with a Dublin accent.
Oh, he's the man. Let me tell you that he has the 150% support of the FAI going forward.
It was in one morning I woke up that I didn't say, you're the manager of the Irish international team with the responsibility to everybody who was in football in Ireland. That's how I felt about it.
It was a huge step up. Kerr was responsible for managing big-name players and planning tactics for big championship games. The media glare took some getting used to.
You know, I like to think I treated all the media with reasonable respect. The demands of my time, because I lived in Ireland, were at times I felt quite unreasonable because I was around and they were used to me being around.
It's through towards Robbie Keane, it's a second goal! To mark his return! Morrison has scored!
After a steady start, Irish results took a turn for the worst in the 2006 World Cup qualifiers.
Swan!
Oh! It was a dreadful match against a poor side.
Kerr is a very, very defensive coach.
This is the World Cup. It's not the Leinster League.
And 2 points have been thrown into the Mediterranean.
I'd much prefer to take on the job of being the manager and make the mistakes, so be it if they are mistakes, but take on that challenge and do it rather than talk about doing it.
Kerr's relationship with the media soured. There was rumours of Barneys with the boys on the FAI board. His ability to manage at senior level was called into question. Some journalists claimed he'd lost the respect of the players.
I've told you frequently in the past, I don't do bust-ups with players, whatever about with journalists.
The controversies of recent days with the media and with the FAI were of his own making.
There's only 11 who are ever happy, the ones who play, right? If there's ones who are not playing, they're always vulnerable, and media people understand that. They're the ones who are likely to make a few comments that can start a bit of a roll.
The match against France in September 2006 proved a turning point, and Kerr's Waterloo.
Wiltord and Henri. Oh, that's a super goal by Thierry.
Defeat left Irish hopes in tatters.
That's a disaster.
Then a scoreless draw against Switzerland quashed Ireland's chance of ever reaching the World Cup finals.
Final whistle and Ireland are out of the World Cup.
This is a dark night for Irish soccer. I don't think this guy has the plot anymore, to be honest.
He's not going to survive, surely, is he?
No doubt, Bill, a change is required.
Yeah.
Kerr's Irish international coaching career came to a sudden and screeching halt.
I don't know whether many Irish managers went out on a win and a draw. It certainly didn't do me any favours with the FAI that we lost the game with France, of course.
The board has indicated that the FAI is to recruit a new international manager
to succeed Brian Kerr, whose contract expired at the end of World Cup 2006 campaign.
I think, as Owen Hand once said, there are only two things certain in life. You will die, and football managers get sacked. And when you go into it, you know that. But that is life as a football manager. So while there's an awful lot of pleasures and rewards to go with it, you have to accept that it's unlikely to end well.
With O2, Christmas comes twice. Buy any prepaid phone today, just top it up by €20 a month, and next summer you'll get another one free. O2. Together is better.
Fed up paying the same price for insurance as careless drivers? Well, at AXA, we give safe driving discounts of up to 75%. That's more than any other insurance company. For great value car and home insurance, get in touch today. AXA, redefining standards.
Some other fish fingers might look the same as bird's eye, but they're not. Ours are made with 100% fish fillet, and they're rich in omega-3. So make sure your fish fingers are bird's eye, Ireland's favourite.
And just a gigolo, and everywhere I go, people know the part I'm playing. Paid for every dance, selling his romance. Oh, what they say. There will come a day, and youth will pass away. What will they say about me? When the end comes, I know they'll say just a gigolo. Life goes on without me, cause
I ain't got nobody.
Okay, what's your name, please?
Oh, I'm sorry, I've already got a boyfriend.
Yorkie, it's not for girls.
Well, you love puzzle games, you two, don't you?
And brain training was the first game I got, and then I saw Professor Layton. It's just something a bit different, you know, draws you in, and there's little surprises here and there.
There's a new Professor Layton out, Pandora's Box.
Yeah.
Have you played that?
I'm probably a third of the way through it, I think.
You're a little bit jealous?
I am a little bit.
What's the difference between Curious Village and Pandora's Box?
There are more intriguing puzzles, and then when you come across puzzles and then go back somewhere, you discover there was a puzzle you missed.
So how about a bit of a Professor Layton challenge?
Yeah, I've just finished one of them. Train swap.
How many moves have you done it in?
15.
Come on, Deck.
Find out who cracked this Professor Layton challenge with the fewest moves at enjoynintendo.com.
It's the new DVD for me, Neil Delamere.
More freckles than any man's body I've never seen, but blind people can read him. That's how freckly he is.
Ben Delamere on DVD now.
The days may be getting darker, but the nights are getting brighter. Because it's party season, girls. The season to be fabulous. Enjoy a low-fat cereal for breakfast, like Kellogg's Special K. Because those who do tend to be slimmer than those who don't. Go on, set this party season alight. Kellogg's Special K. Be fabulous.
Will you win €1 million with prize bonds this month?
Now aged 56, Brian Kerr is starting over again in the Faroe Islands, managing the national football team. Tomorrow he will lead an amateur team with an 8-year losing streak in a showdown against the French. There's a strong chance the match will be a deja vu reminder of Kerr's final days at the top of Irish soccer. He hopes it'll be the beginning of the end of his wilderness years.
I was hugely disappointed that my contract wasn't renewed, but I could see the writing on the wall for that for a good while in advance of it. I knew unless we qualified for the World Cup and possibly won it, it was unlikely to get my contract renewed. Afterwards, I had some offers, but there was nothing that really, really attracted me. And I suppose I had in my head I wanted to go away, I wanted to do something different. And but the right thing didn't come. And then the longer I was out, I suppose you become maybe forgotten a little bit, but you're also losing contact, so your phone rings a lot less.
The Faroe Islands offers Kerr a chance to revive his career. But the challenge is phenomenal when the players are part-timers.
Beardyr, the kit man, he walks in the prison and he had the prisoners over cutting the grass on Friday. But obviously they must have been only on a half day and they didn't finish it. But it's not really tight enough. But there you go. It all happens in the Faroe Islands. The kit man brings the prisoners to cut the grass and then he gets a bit of stick on Sunday because it wasn't cut tight enough, you know. Let them prisoners out. We need them in here more often. There are huge, huge reasons why one would want to be here. And, you know, there are things that are different here that I like. And I think I've always tried to have a balance in my life between the irrationality of times of football and how we live and die by results and the seriousness of it and there's maybe a lot of the spoof and spin that goes around professional football.
The French arrive in the Faroes the evening before the match, but the greeting scrum of fans is smaller than they're used to. Les Bleus expect to win, they usually do. The French come from a different world, a world of celebrity, fat cat agents and overblown transfer fees. Nicolas Anelka is worth 20 million euro. Karim Benzema, 30 million. And Frank Ribéry is worth a reported 50 million euro. There are only a handful of hotels in the Faroe Islands, so bizarrely the two teams share pre-match digs. For the Faroese, meeting the French up close and personal may be as near as they get to the top. The parallels are not lost on Brian Kerr.
But that's the television station, isn't it?
The challenge is the same, and I've enjoyed it thoroughly. The scheming and the preparation in terms of taking on the French team and all the might.
With a nervous night to go before kick-off, the battle of wits has already begun.
You go with power and pace. We will have seven against six.
As Brian goes through last-minute tactics with the Faroe team, the French face the international press.
Faroe Island be very difficult to win tomorrow.
He's liable to do anything. He's liable to do something crazy.
Brian may have painful memories of his last run-in with the French, but it seems manager Raymond Domenech has only vague recollections of the milestone.
I remember about the team on the pitch, but the trainers, and fight.
Too casual, too much thinking about always attacking, but not always defending very well.
Do you expect to win easily tomorrow?
Sure, I expect. Every time.
Mm-hmm. It's match day, and for the moment, pre-game nerves are under control.
Good morning.
How are you?
It's lovely, isn't it?
It's his final coaching session before the big match. Kerr names the starting lineup and fires up the Faroe team.
Today I would like us to start from the first kick of the ball, that there's a tackle made up in the pitch up here. There's a chase, and if somebody gets a dunt, and it has a problem. It'll be fast and furious, and we must play a lot faster. We must be able for that at the beginning. Ready to go, ready to play faster.
Of course I'm edgy on the match day, and one of the staff said to me last night, he said, you're under more pressure than the Prime Minister here at the moment. How does that feel? I said, I've had it before. It was just a different place.
Faroe Island matches rarely catch international media interest, except when the celebrated French are in town. The contrast between teams couldn't be greater.
I think the French team will win.
3-1 to France.
3-0.
3-0.
5-0.
Maybe a draw.
The French players like Ribéry and Benzema and Gallas and Evra and Sanya, etc., compared to Freddy Benjaminson, who was down doing his carpentry, and Sonny working in the fish factory. And, you know, it is a huge contrast. Which one would you rather have your son have? You know, it's an interesting one. Maybe it's stupid to even consider that one should not have all the riches and wealth in the world. But at times, maybe not respectful of people who do ordinary jobs and ordinary life, because you're out of touch. These players here are certainly in touch with life and reality.
With game on, the Faroes are quickly put under pressure, their backs against the wall. The French attack in waves, but the Faroese defence holds tighter than Kerr's nerves.
Well, I think in general I'm at a stage where I'm generally quite composed in games.
For fuck's sake! You fucking fucked them out of there! That's a terrible fucking. You saw it yourself, you fucking.
Eyes up. Spoiler.
You know, I'm back in this, and I have every ball of it.
You ever mind your team? Yeah, I understand you, yeah?
I've been with teams and had frustrations and ups and downs, and saying been robbed by referees and lots of decisions over the years.
Respect, please. Okay? You respect me as a coach.
You hear managers in the various leagues complaining that the big teams always get the decisions, they get the penalties and the red cards given against the smaller teams, and they don't get penalties.
There's no yellow card, no? Three yellow cards. It's home. Small nation. You do a small nation. Yeah, I know.
So I have to stand up for them, because I think I can influence almost nearly every kick of the ball, because I can help with the decision making. Maybe you don't. Maybe you don't, but you can't let them just run over you, you know, like the Russian tanks.
As halftime approaches, the Faroes hold their nerve, defend like demons, and on occasion ride their luck. The French are frustrated. But then moments before halftime, the game reaches a turning point.
Unbelievable effort. But we must use the ball better, and we must protect the ball better.
second half, and with the support of new manager Brian Kerr, the Faroese underdogs face down the French. They courageously will themselves not to give up a second goal.
They're full of heart and determination and grit. And you sense it in the crowd as well, that they know if it's late on and there's not too much difference in the score, that we might get that chance.
Faroes lose 1-0 to France.
Yeah, loneliness in football is after games. If result doesn't go for you, it's a lonely place being the manager. There's nothing people can say or do that can help your head, really. You know, it's a very deep feeling of upset and disappointment and annoyance and frustration and what ifs and so on. Already I've had two games and we've lost both of them. But with experience, you get to deal with it and you go, right, what have I learned and what can I implement for the next one that will make it better?
Proud of the effort, proud of the performance, but we lost. Many of you will learn from today. In the media, say good things, because you deserve to have good things said about you. Okay? So give yourselves a round of applause. All right? Give yourselves a applause. Okay, do what we have to do.
I feel that they're nearly like family, these people already that I'm working with. I feel a sense of loyalty from them already. But I think these are very good people and very honest people, and I like that. I better go and do some of the pressing.
The 1-0 defeat to one of the top teams in the world is still a good result for the Faroe Islands. The irony is not lost on Brian Kerr. It's the same result against the same team that cost him the Irish job. Brian Kerr is now on a very different journey. This time it's about redemption, reviving his passion for the game, and striving towards the moment it all proves worthwhile. After all, football is a results business.
Unfortunately, I may be measured by the results of a team that it's almost impossible to win matches with. But I quite enjoy that challenge of doing something with somebody that most people would give us no chance with. I just hope that it all clicks one day, that we get that lucky day, and I'll give it my best here too. Come up with results that make the public here happy and the team happy and me happy and the association happy enough to maybe give me renew my contract when the time comes.
Your fucking flag up.
Right in front of you. There, right in front of you.
It's a modelito. What you want that, Jim?
Yeah!
Yeah! Coming up on top stage! Top of the air, drive me up now. Show me on the air, do it.
Go ahead, pull me down!
Baby, you're just dancing in the night and yet.
And now for tonight's All or Nothing draw, and the numbers are 1, 2, 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, 12, 13, 15, 16 and 22. And don't forget, you can check the winning numbers on lottery.ie or Airtel page 152.
I'm Louie.
And I'm Bertie.
And we're the S Factor Twins.
Tell us about the Euro Crunch offers, brother.
Strong's Firelogs 5-pack, only €2.